system is not on. Our chief technician, Dean Dart, is going to fix it.
Check. There we go.
It's working.
There you go.
This is working now. Okay. Good morning, everyone. Not only are the mics not working, my voice is not working as well as it normally is, but I assure you I am not contagious. So welcome, everybody. Welcome, welcome, welcome to St. George's Cathedral on this last Sunday in February. As always, we acknowledge that in Kingston, we are situated on the traditional territory of the Anishinaabe, Haudenosaunee, and the Huron-Wendat peoples. We seek a new relationship with the original peoples of this land, one rooted in and based upon honor and deep respect. Not only should I welcome all of you, but especially welcome visitors who are with us this morning. We want you to feel very welcome. We're delighted that you've joined us, and we hope that you can join us for coffee hour after the service in the back of the church. And speaking of that, Sylvia Green would want me to tell you that they're still always looking for volunteers for coffee hour. I think we're good till about the third Sunday in March, Doug and Sylvia, but we always need more volunteers. It's an important part of what we do here at the Cathedral. I want to mention two other things. First of all, that there's going to be a fun afternoon here at the Cathedral today. The Melos Choir and Ensemble are having their fundraising tea, recital, and silent auction. And that takes place at 3 o'clock this afternoon at the Cathedral. And finally, next Sunday will be different here at the Cathedral. Next Sunday is our annual vestry meeting. It's the annual meeting of members of the Cathedral. And so what we do is combine our 8 a.m. and 10:30 services, and we start our service at 10 a.m. next week. One service, 10 a.m. next week, and then we'll have the vestry meeting afterwards at 11:30. So we hope that all of you can join us for that. Always important things to be voted on and discussed for the coming year. I think that's it. Let's begin our service now. Oh, sorry. Is that why you're standing there? TJ, you wanted to say something. I'm sorry.
Good morning. What I'm doing is I'm making a plea. I need help with the Altar Guild. One of our team members, husband and wife team, are moving to Ottawa. And so I am now down a team, which means a few of us work triple time. So if you are interested in setting up, tearing down, washing holy dishes, rolling wafers, and the occasional polishing, please contact me and we'll get you set up on a team. Thank you.
Thank you, TJ. Now, let the service begin.
Would you stand, please? The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with thy spirit.
Almighty God, unto whom all hearts be open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of thy Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love thee and worthily magnify thy holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ said, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord, and thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, and with all thy soul, and with all thy mind, and with all thy strength. This is the first and great commandment, and the second is like unto it, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets.
Lord, have mercy upon us,
and write both these thy laws on our hearts,
we beseech thee.
Almighty God, whose Son was revealed in majesty before he suffered death upon the cross, give us faith to perceive his glory, that being strengthened by his grace, we may be changed into his likeness from glory to glory, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Please be seated for the proclamation of the word.
A reading from the book of Genesis. When Abram was 99 years old, the Lord appeared to Abram and said to him, I am God Almighty. Walk before me and be blameless. And I will make my covenant between me and you, and I will make you exceedingly numerous. Then Abram fell on his face, and God said to him, as for me, this is my covenant with you. You shall be the ancestor of a multitude of nations. No longer shall your name be Abram, but your name shall be Abraham, for I have made you the ancestor of a multitude of nations. I will make you exceedingly fruitful, and I will make nations of you, and kings shall come from you. I will establish my covenant between me and you, and your offspring after you, throughout their generations, for an everlasting covenant. to be God to you and to your offspring after you. As for Sarai, your wife, you shall not call her Sarai, but Sarah shall be her name. I will bless her, and moreover, I will give you a son by her. I will bless her, and she shall give rise to nations. Kings of peoples shall come from her. The word of the Lord. A reading from the letter of Paul to the Romans. The promise that he would inherit the world did not come to Abraham or to his descendants through the law, but through the righteousness of faith. If it is the adherents of the law who are to be the heirs, faith is null and the promise is void. For the law brings wrath. But where there is no law, neither is there violation. For this reason, it depends on faith. In order that the promise may rest on grace and be guaranteed to all his descendants, not only to the adherents of the law, but also to those who share the faith of Abraham. For he is the father of all of us, as it is written, I have made you the father of many nations. In the presence of the God in whom he believed, who gives life to the dead and calls into existence the things that do not exist. Hoping against hope, he believed that he would become the father of many nations according to what was said. So numerous shall your descendants be. He did not weaken in faith when he considered his own body, which was already as good as dead, though he was about 100 years old, or when he considered the barrenness of Sarah's womb. No distrust made him waver concerning the promise of God, but he grew strong in his faith as he gave glory to God, being fully convinced that God was able to do what he had promised. Therefore, his faith was reckoned to him as righteousness. Now, the words, "it was reckoned to him," were written not for his sake alone, but for ours also. It will be reckoned to us who believe in him who raised Jesus our Lord from the dead, who was handed over to death for our trespasses and was raised for our justification. The word of the Lord.
Be with you.
And with
thy spirit. The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Mark.
Glory to thee, Lord Christ.
6 days later, Jesus took with him Peter and James and John and led them up a high mountain apart by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his clothes became dazzling white, such as no one on earth could bleach them. And there appeared to him Elijah with Moses, who were talking with Jesus. Then Peter said to Jesus, "Rabbi, it is good for us to be here. Let us make three dwellings, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." He did not know what to say, for they were terrified. Then a cloud overshadowed them, and from the cloud there came a voice, "This is my son, the beloved. Listen to him." Suddenly, when they looked around, they saw no one with them anymore, but only Jesus. As they were coming down the mountain, he ordered them to tell no one about what they had seen until after the Son of Man had risen from the dead. This is the gospel of Christ.
Praise
to you.
Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be now and always acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Back in the spring before we left South Africa, Vanessa and I took the kids on safari. Nothing fancy, just us bundled into our trusty Nissan X-Trail, heading up to Botswana to meet up there with some friends, and then all of us heading out into the bush to see the wilds of the African savanna. Elephant, giraffe, rhinoceros at the watering hole, the big cats. Kids were able to see and appreciate sights and experiences that we weren't sure they would get to see again. And then, just for fun, we took them out onto a salt pan. I have no idea how wide it was across, miles and miles and miles, where nothing lives, nothing even grows, so that we could spend a night under the stars, surrounded by literally nothing but miles of crusted sand below us and the infinite Milky Way above. Absolutely glorious. And then on the way back out of the salt pan, right on the edge, we stopped to visit a meerkat colony. So in case you were wondering, that's the picture that you have on the front of your bulletin this morning. Now, meerkats are great little creatures. They're members of the mongoose family, very sociable, very playful. Iconically, they're pictured just like this because there are always some standing on guard duty while others forage for food, which they will share with the colony. And that's not the only job that meerkats share. Some of the older adults in the colony serve as teachers, actively showing the juveniles how to hunt scorpions, for example, how to hold them, how to remove the stingers. And young females who don't have pups of their own yet, they become babysitters, and they look after all the colony's youngsters together in a common nursery, ready to defend them with their own lives should danger threaten. Jesus was once teaching his disciples, and he said to them, "If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. I have said these things to you so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. And this is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. No one has greater love than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. You are my friends if you do what I command you." Meerkats are not just sociable with each other, looking out for each other, even dying to protect each other. They're also sociable with complete strangers. They're cautious, of course, but if you approach a meerkat colony very gently, very calmly, and sit down and patiently wait, their curiosity will overcome their caution. Because even though they live with the constant threat of predators, meerkats are not fearful animals. If you sit quietly enough with them, eventually the guard meerkats will climb up onto your shoulder to use you as a lookout. Because standing on the shoulders of this new creature allows them to see further than they can standing on their own two legs. So now, why the nature lesson? Let's assume that I haven't only been sharing some happy memories with you, but that there is actually a point to this little tale as well. What do you think that might be? How would you work that out? Well, the first step in this case is to realize that actually I've told you two stories, not one. There was the story of our family jaunt into the wilderness, ending with our little meerkat adventure, and there was Jesus' lesson on love to his disciples, which I plonked right into the middle of the meerkat story, deliberately, so that the meerkat story formed a kind of bracket of meaning, if you like, around the Jesus story. The way I've told this little tale to you, if you were listening carefully, the meerkat story becomes a kind of metaphor for the Jesus story. And the Jesus story gives a certain context to the meerkat story. And it's in the connections between these stories that the lesson lies. And what exactly are those connections in this case? Well, it's that God weaves a certain kind of love right through creation. It's that responding to God's love happens in a certain kind of community in which its members care for one another and look out for one another and help meet each other's needs, sometimes even sacrificing themselves for the sake of each other. It's that community is not bounded by blood or by clan, or in the case of the meerkats, not even by species necessarily. True community is dynamic. It makes space for everyone, each celebrating the gifts of the other, each sharing their gifts with the other. Because real community is formed by the openness of its interactions, not by the policing of its boundaries. And that is what the self-giving love of God looks like. So that's the first point of sharing these two stories with you, to say something about the self-giving love of God and to say something about how we might share that with each other. But there was a second point to sharing these stories with you as well, a little more subtle perhaps, something of a technical lesson, if you like. Because what I did, deliberately telling one story within another, so that you have to think about both of them together in order to understand them, that is a writing style that you will find right through the Gospels, and in Mark's Gospel in particular, used by him to help readers not only hear something about God, but in having to make those connections in their own minds, helping people to internalize and understand for themselves something about the nature of God. And the challenge for us, of course, as we read these stories within stories, or intercalations, as they're technically called, the challenge is that we most often read the Gospels in neat little bite-sized chunks on a Sunday morning, and we completely miss the meanings that emerge across whole chapters of stories. Which is why, as a general principle, it's always good to pause and ask of anything we've read in the scriptures whether it is a little snippet from within a larger story around it, or whether it's part of a framing story that needs us to read something else alongside it. And all of that I give you because the story of Jesus' transfiguration, which we've read this morning, is exactly such a case in point. Mark describes how Jesus went up the mountain with James and John, where they saw him transformed, his countenance dazzling white, shining with all the glory of the divine, as Moses and Elijah stood nearby. And the disciples, we read, wanted to stay in that holy moment as long as they could. But the moment passed, and Jesus brought them back down the mountain, back into the real world, where they would need to live and work. What's that story all about? By itself, that story's about lots of things. It's about Jesus' relationship with the Father. It's about Jesus ushering in a new covenant, the successor to Moses, in a sense. It's about the reality of eternal life, proved by those who had gone before, coming to stand with Jesus then. All of those things are important truths worth contemplating. But none of those truths capture the life-changing power of that encounter, because they miss that this story is not actually about what Jesus does. It's about what the disciples will choose to do. So I'm going to give you a bit of a bird's eye view to make that clear. Up to that point in Mark's gospel, Jesus' life had challenged people with a simple question. Confronted by the reality of Christ, by his call to repentance, what will your response to Jesus be? You can deny Christ and then just go on with business as usual, or you can accept Christ and follow. But to follow means to repent, to profoundly change your life so that it reflects the love of God. And that's not always easy, because sometimes those changes can feel positively sacrificial. Matthew, for example, who left behind his prosperous tax-collecting business, which could have made him a wealthy man, choosing instead to go where Jesus went. There's a price to pay in different kinds of ways for leaving old ways behind to become someone new. And paying that price takes a certain kind of genuine trust. When Jesus sent his disciples out to share the good news of God with others, he instructed them as they traveled from village to village to carry no bread, take no bag, no money, have a staff with you and a single pair of sandals and one tunic. And he tasked them with inviting people into a new kind of community, living into that, being dependent as they were on the kindness of those they were inviting to be a new people. How do you do that? How do you risk vulnerability with others when you're feeling tired and hungry and unsafe yourself? Well, that's where Mark drops into the narrative, the story of Jesus asking his disciples to feed 5,000 people with nothing but 5 loaves of bread and 2 small fish. And the disciples couldn't do it. They didn't understand how. So Jesus did, leaving 12 baskets of leftovers. Well, did that fantastic event make things easier for the disciples to grasp? Apparently not, because right after that, they get into a boat and head out into the water, and a storm comes up, and immediately again, they feel ill-equipped and unsafe and alone. So Jesus came to them, walking on the water, calming the storm, and they were saved. But Mark makes a very explicit point there that their fear was all because they did not understand about the loaves. And so shortly after that, Mark drops another feeding miracle into the story, same as before. 7 loaves this time, a few small fish, 4,000 people, disciples are stymied, Jesus produces 7 baskets of leftovers. And then immediately afterward, Jesus has the disciples get back into a boat, head back out onto the water, see what they've learned now. And what's the topic of conversation this time? Ironically, that they've forgotten to bring any bread with them. So again, Jesus has to say to them, "What did you just see me do?" Whether you have bread with you or not is irrelevant. What is it into which you are really putting your faith? And when they land on the other side, Jesus goes on to teach, "Those who would follow me should deny themselves, take up their cross, follow me, trust me, have faith, because I've got you. And how will you know that this is true?" And that's where the story of the Transfiguration comes. not just to tell us about who Jesus is, but to answer the question, if I'm going to follow God's path of sacrificial love for others, if I'm going to do that in the kind of self-giving way that lets go of the things in which I used to place my trust, in what will I place my trust now? And the answer is in the Christ, who is more than what he seems, and who doesn't actually have to be with you in order to be with you. You trust the Christ, who has been consistently sufficient and more for your needs. We trust the Christ, who calls us to offer one another really only what we have already received, the love of the God who is with us and who calls us to be with each other. Feed the hungry, clothe the naked, heal the broken, welcome the stranger, forgive those who don't yet now know how to do that, and show them the way. Do that even when you feel ill-equipped, because you know that following God doesn't mean never having to face challenge. It means doing whatever will build God's kingdom anyway, even if it makes us uncomfortable or fearful, because deep down we know that God can be trusted, that people are worth it, because once we've seen the light of Christ shining in the world, how can the darkness ever be compelling again? May that be our sure hope and our commitment again this Lent. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Let us confess our faith as we say, I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of the Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, through whom all things were made, who for us and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Ghost of the Virgin Mary and was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures and ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of the Father. And he shall come again with glory to judge both the quick and the dead, whose kingdom shall have no end. And I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceedeth from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spake by the prophets. And I believe one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sin. And I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Sitting, standing, or kneeling, let us pray. Creator God, we pray for those who sent to us to lead your church, for William, our bishop, Doug, our dean, and our associate priests, as they bring us together into the light of Christ. Lord, in your mercy, hear us. Creator God, your Son taught us to seek your hand in the beauty and wonders of the earth and the sea and the sky. Help us to remember that the earth belongs to you and use the resources here more wisely. Lord, in your mercy. Creator God, allow those who govern the capacity, foresight, and willingness to act decisively for the benefit of all your people in this community of Kingston. So many are suffering outside our doors, struggling with mental health, addictions, homelessness. Be a beacon of light for them in these hard times. Lord, in your mercy. Creator God, send your healing touch upon those who are sick, remembering especially those mentioned on our prayer list, those in our hearts, and those who care for them, giving them rest for today and hope for tomorrow. Lord, in your mercy. We remember those who have died, especially Jean Robinson. We pray for all who mourn the loss of loved ones, that Christ may comfort them. We thank you for those who have traveled the way of the cross and are now at peace in your eternal presence. Lord, in your mercy. Creator God, we pray for peace in the Middle East. There's so much violence and tragedy in this world, not only in the Middle East, but in Ukraine and other areas of the world. Show mercy on those who suffer so unjustly. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, we ask that you hear our prayers and grant us and those we pray for new life and hope through faith in your infinite love and generosity. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Ye that do truly and earnestly repent you of your sins, and are in love and charity with your neighbors, and intend to lead the new life, following the commandments of God, and walking from henceforth in his holy ways, draw near with faith, and take this holy sacrament to your comfort, and make your humble confession to Almighty God. Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, maker of all things and judge of all people, we acknowledge and confess our manifold sins and wickedness, which we from time to time most grievously have committed, by thought, word, and deed, against thy divine majesty. We do earnestly repent, and are heartily sorry for these our misdoings. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father, for thy Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may ever hereafter serve and please thee in newness of life, to the honor and glory of thy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, our heavenly Father, who of his great mercy hath promised forgiveness of sins to all them that with hearty repentance and true faith turn unto him, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and bring you to everlasting life, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
My sisters and brothers in Christ, the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And with your spirit.
Peace God. Peace.
Thank you.
may the light of the eternal Word, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, guide us to your glory. We ask this in his name.
Amen. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks unto our Lord God. It is very meet, right, and our bounden duty that we should at all times and in all places give thanks unto thee, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty, Everlasting God, Creator and Preserver of all things, who hast bidden us, thy faithful people, to cleanse our hearts and to prepare with joy for the Paschal feast, that reborn through the waters of baptism and renewed in the Eucharistic mystery, we may be more fervent in prayer and more generous in works of love. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify thy glorious name, evermore praising thee and saying, blessing and glory and thanksgiving be unto thee, Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who of thy tender mercy didst give thine only Son, Jesus Christ, to take our nature upon him and to suffer death upon the cross for our redemption, who made there, by his one oblation of himself once offered, a full, perfect, and sufficient sacrifice, oblation and satisfaction for the sins of the whole world, and did institute, and in his holy gospel command us to continue, a perpetual memorial of that his precious death until his coming again. Hear us, O merciful Father, we most humbly beseech thee, and grant that we, receiving these thy creatures of bread and wine, according to thy Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ's holy institution,
in remembrance of his death and passion, may be partakers of his most blessed body and blood. Who in the same night that he was betrayed took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Likewise, after supper, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink ye all of this, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the remission of sins. Do this as oft as ye shall drink it in remembrance of me." Wherefore, O Father, Lord of heaven and earth, we thy humble servants with all thy holy church, remembering the precious death of thy beloved Son, his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming again in glory, do make before thee, in this sacrament of the holy bread of eternal life and the cup of everlasting salvation, the memorial which he hath commanded. We praise thee, we bless thee, we thank thee, and we pray to thee, Lord our God. And we entirely desire thy fatherly goodness, mercifully to accept this our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, most humbly beseeching thee to grant that by the merits and death of thy Son, Jesus Christ, and through faith in his blood, we and all thy whole church may obtain remission of our sins and all other benefits of his passion. And we pray that by the power of thy Holy Spirit, all we who are partakers of this holy communion may be fulfilled with thy grace and heavenly benediction, through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory be unto thee, O Father Almighty, world without end.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We do not presume to come to this thy table, O merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in thy manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under thy table, but thou art the same Lord, whose property is always to have mercy. Grant us therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of thy Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that we may evermore dwell in him, and he in us. Amen.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Creator of heaven and earth, we thank you for these holy mysteries, which bring us now a share in the life to come. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Glory to God, whose power working in us can do infinitely more than we can ask or imagine. Glory to God from generation to generation, in the Church and in Christ Jesus, forever and ever. Amen. Life is short, and we do not have much time to gladden the hearts of those who journey with us. And so make haste to love, and be swift to be kind. And may the God who travels with us, the God of pilgrimage, the God of hope, bless, care, and keep you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Go forth into the world, rejoicing in the power of the Spirit.